In April 2017, an unremarkable plane was flying over the mountains of Afghanistan. It became more remarkable when a parachute flew out of its open ramp and pulled out an unusual cargo. This cargo rushed to the ground and soon stuck into the rock at the foot of the mountain. A moment later, this food blew up. A huge ball of flame burned everything around, and the shockwave demolished buildings located hundreds of meters from the epicenter. Stunned by the roar of the explosion, people witnessed the use of the most powerful non-nuclear aviation munition. The mother of all bombs showed its power. When it comes to the history of large aerial bombs, one that immediately comes to mind is the Grand Slam, the British aerial bomb used during World War II against German fortifications and underground facilities. This bomb was gigantic, 8 meters long, and weighed 10 tons. After being dropped from a maximum height, the bomb accelerated to supersonic speeds, pierced the earth, and exploded with a power of 6.5 tons of TNT, causing a seismic shockwave capable of destroying a large underground object, which is why it was called an earthquake bomb. The Americans, of course, could not ignore such beauty, and in 1944 they created their own analog, the T-12 Cloudmaker bomb. This monster weighed 19 tons. The bomb was so big and heavy that only the gigantic Convair B-36 Peacemaker could carry it. But times have changed. The atomic bomb became the leader of all charts in the field of mass destruction, and everyone had forgotten about conventional high-powered explosives. The aforementioned Cloudmaker was never used in practice. However, in the early 1970s, when the United States were fighting in Vietnam, they had a serious need for high-yield aerial bombs. The idea that nuclear weapons could be used anywhere and for any reason had already been replaced by adequacy, and such goals had to be achieved by conventional methods. This is how the Blue 82B was born. Unlike the previously described monsters, the Blue did not impress with either appearance or size. It weighed about 6.8 tons and could be dropped not from huge bombers, but from the C-130 Hercules medium transports, and even from the CH-54 Skycrane helicopter, moreover, from a low altitude. And while being many times inferior to its predecessors in the total mass, it was close to them in terms of explosive mass, 5.7 tons. And all these differences are explained by the concept. Earthquake bombs were so heavy due to the high proportion of high-strength steel that was needed to penetrate soil, rock, and concrete. But this bomb was practically a barrel of gunpowder. It did not penetrate anywhere and exploded near the ground itself, working on an area. It destroyed structures, thickets, and concentrations of troops within a radius of up to 300 meters, a kind of pinpoint alternative to carpet bombing. Moreover, it was often used to create empty areas in the jungle where helicopters could land. This work gave the bomb a nickname, Daisy Cutter. Despite all the absurdity, this bomb was produced and used from the 1970s until the beginning of the 21st century. And every time, the explosion was very impressive to everyone. In Iraq, it was not necessary to clear the jungle, but it was good at creating panic, even among allies. During Operation Desert Storm, British SAS soldiers who noticed the explosion of the Blue 82B began to report to the command about the use of nuclear weapons. And then, convinced of the effectiveness of the Blue 82B, the US Air Force thought about replacing it with something new and improved. And the conclusion was obvious. How can the most powerful non-nuclear bomb in the world be improved? That's right, by making it even more powerful. The project, called Massive Ordnance Air Blast, or MOAB, was initiated by the Air Force in 2002. In addition to increased power, it was supposed to improve the aerodynamic quality, get guidance and control systems, becoming a full-fledged guided bomb. Since the United States at that time was preparing for a military operation in Iraq, the order was urgent, and the work was carried out very quickly. The bomb received the official index GBU-43B. Despite its already cult status, the MOAB, by and large, remains a classic high-explosive aerial bomb, just very big and with perks. It is 9.2 meters long, weighs 9.8 tons, and is smaller in diameter than the Blue 82B, but longer to improve aerodynamics, further enhanced by a pair of hull stretch stabilizers, similar to clipped wings. Control is managed by four folding grid fins, which are quite effective and common, mainly on rockets of different classes. They can be seen both on air-to-air missiles and on large carriers, for example in the first stage of the Falcon 9 rocket. The electronic control is advanced, but quite classic for modern precision-guided munitions. It combines inertial and satellite navigation. The MOAB, being Daisy Cutter's successor, also inherited a huge share of its deadly filling. The case is aluminum, lightweight, electronics take up little space and don't weigh much, so out of 9.8 tons of total mass, 8.5 tons are explosives. 8.5 tons. Moreover, this is not TNT. This is the so-called Composition H6, a potent mixture of explosives, which is more powerful than conventional explosives of the same mass, by about 30-35%. Thus, the MOAB, when detonated, generates an explosion with a capacity of about 11 tons of TNT. After conducting two strikes at the test sites, the bomb was declared the most powerful in the conventional class. And among the public, MOAB began to be decoded as the mother of all bombs. The concept of application is the same as that of its predecessor. The GBU-43 on a special platform is loaded onto the C-130. Above the drop point, the aircraft opens the ramp, the brake parachute pulls the platform overboard, after which the bomb separates and goes into a controlled fall. It is detonated at a minimum height near the ground or after penetrating the ground to a shallow depth. According to various estimates and test results, the bomb's explosion is capable of causing serious damage within a radius of more than a kilometer. With an explosion in the ground, this radius is significantly reduced. But it is enough to, for example, demolish unfortified buildings at a distance of about 150 meters. By order of the Air Force, the McAllister plant produced a batch of 15 units and handed them over to the military. According to various estimates, each bomb cost about $170,000, not counting the cost of the program, the equivalent of modern-day $250,000. Expensive for an aerial bomb, but in small quantities, acceptable. And so, the US Air Force, rather quickly and after spectacular tests, received their bombs. Let's see how they used them. Suddenly, there was a funny revelation. It turned out that the militants of various hostile groups are based either in cities and villages, which means that the use of the MOAB will lead to massive destruction and death of civilians, or they are hiding in small groups in mountain caves, and the MOAB is simply redundant to use. There, often, conventional high-precision bombs like the JDAM is enough. As a result, it came to the real use of the bomb only in 2017, when it was dropped on a cave complex in eastern Afghanistan. The explosion was loud and bright, and according to authorities, it destroyed the complex, burying about 100 militants under the rocks. In fact, it is not clear how effective this blast was, and it is not so important. This task was rather political. Someone in the White House was offended that such a cool thing was never used. And yes, that strike has remained the only combat use of the MOAB at the moment. The result of 15 years of storage in the arsenal made it clear that the GBU-43B is not particularly effective, or rather not needed in the war against terrorism. There is no need to clear the jungle in Afghanistan and Iraq. There are no large and concentrated military groups here either, and using this monster against small groups in caves is the same as fighting garden rodents with artillery. And using it against much more serious potential targets like underground military installations is ineffective. The MOAB is not a bunker buster. Much more promising in the niche of anti-bunker weapons is its sister and conceptual successor to the Grand Slam and Cloudmaker bombs, the GBU-57AB MOP, which stands for Massive Ordnance Penetrator. The MOP is similar in appearance to the MOAB. It is also controlled, has similar guidance systems, aerodynamic surfaces, and grid fins. But with all the external similarity, it being a penetrator is made differently. Its dimensions are smaller, as is the mass of the warhead. There is only about 2.5 tons of explosives. Meanwhile, the amount of metal in it is much larger, so in total it is heavier. It weighs as much as 12.3 tons. Since penetrators require much more speed on impact, the MOAB is dropped from high altitudes by strategic bombers. As a result, all this is capable of penetrating to objects located at a depth of up to 61 meters. 61 meters. Imagine a bomb that, without any drills and engines, breaks through a stone slab as thick as a 20-story building. Ironically, the MOAB, being potentially much more useful in war, is in fact much less known, because it is not the most powerful, and no one cares about the second places, only the first, even if they are in fact useless MacGuffins. This is where the story ends. If you enjoyed it, please leave a like and your opinion in the comments. Maybe other relatives of the mother of all bombs will appear on the horizon.